Assalamu alaikum, good afternoon. It's my great pleasure, Salman Sheikh, the director of the Brookings Doha Center, to welcome you all to this very special event that we are having today, the distinguished lecture and discussion that we will have with His Excellency Dr. Ibrahim Al-Jafri, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Iraq. I know many of you know of his past, but let me just recount some of his background and his achievements. He, of course, was born in the holy city of Karbala. His family actually claims direct descent from Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He joined the Islamic Dawah Party in 1966, only 7-8 years after its original founding. And he studied in Mosul, which, of course, has hit the headlines over the last year or so in particular. He is, of course, a medical doctor by training. He spent 23 of his years of his life in exile, the first 10 of them in Syria and Iran, and then 13 years in my hometown of London. And then, of course, in 2003, he returned to Iraq. He was Dr. Jafri, of course, became the first president of the Iraqi Governing Council, the Provisional Government of Iraq, established under the U.S.-led Coalition Provisional Authority. And, of course, he was the vice president at the post of the Republic of Iraq in the Iraqi interim government in 2004 and 5, and was the first elected prime minister of Iraq for the Iraqi transitional government in 2005. In fact, that's where I first met him, he recalled, when I was with the United Nations in Baghdad, and it's good to see you here in Doha. He, of course, presided over the preparation and approval of a permanent Iraqi constitution in 2005, and more recently, he's become a member of the House of Representatives for 2 terms and assumed the presidency of the National Alliance. He established the National Reform Trend in May of 2008 and was then also the president of the Iraqi National Alliance, an alliance mainly of Shia parties. He became foreign minister of Iraq in September 2014 and in the incumbent government of Dr. Haider al-Abadi. Of course, he's written several books, studies and researches, including State Approach, Experience and Rule, Women, and the Battle for Identity. The list goes on and on. Again, it's my great pleasure to invite Dr. Ibrahim Al-Jafri, Foreign Minister of Iraq, to join us. He will deliver a lecture for us for the first part of the special event, and then we will enter into conversation with him, which he has very kindly offered to do. So, Dr. Jafri, please.
Assalamu alaikum, jami'an wa rahmatullah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. I would suggest that or speak on the basis of the title of tonight's event, which is Iraq's foreign policy in turbulent regions. I suppose that this is built on 2 pillars. The one, what is the Iraqi foreign policy, and second, the turbulent region. As for the idea of the turbulent region, it is true because there are problems and a lot of tensions all through the Middle East, whether in the neighboring countries of Iraq or in the countries that are farther geographically. They are all witnessing new changes, and in the beginning they witnessed that so-called Arab Spring, and then the new distances began to appear, and and distant tensions began to appear around Iraq. We are living in a region where we have six countries surrounding us: Turkey, Iran, Syria, Saudi Arabia, and Jordan, and Saudi Arabia. These countries, all of them, are neighboring to Iraq, although they have many differences. There is a tension that's clear between Turkey and Syria, and both of them are two neighboring countries for Iraq. And also, and there is some cold relations between Saudi Arabia and Iran. And also, there are tensions between the different countries of the region. In Libya, there are problems. In Yemen, there is a problem. And that applies to Palestine, where there are many problems. So we are facing the countries of the region that are witnessing a lot of turbulence, and it is easy to say that. That's why I think the title of tonight that I received yesterday expresses the real situation on the region. Iraq has a number of constants in its foreign policy. The first constant is that it insists to have a bipolar relationship, and the second dimension is the regional differences. There are the neighboring countries and the countries further than that. We want to have good relations with all these countries and to forget about the old grievances between the countries when there were no initiatives and where their rupture or either Iraq was cutting the relations with others or vice versa. The result was that Iraq was a sort of living a sort of a ghetto, as if it was under blockade. Iraq, the new Iraq, has decided to put an end to that and to deal with these countries in a good, better way. That's why we do not ask, we should not be asked, why do you have relations with so-and-so country? The question should be, why don't you have relations with so-and-so country? Iraq has some common things with the geographically near countries that are near us, geographically and historically. And there are some differences between the countries that are around us, but there are some important and vital factors and interest between Turks, for example, the Tigris and Euphrates that are coming from Turkey into Iraq, and other facts that are regional and geographic. And on the basis of this, it was national that Iraq should put into account that it must have good relations with all these countries. And since the very first day, without any exaggeration, before we begin our duties in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we began our presence in the countries of the region. The first day after my first day was 9th of September. The 9th and the 10th of September, I went to Jeddah to attend a conference to combat terrorism that was held in Jeddah. From Jeddah, I went to Paris, then to New York, then I came back to Baghdad, and then went into my ministry. Working in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs was before going into the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. This means that we focus on the countries around us, not on just doing the routine roles of the minister. Since that time, the events have been accelerating, and we had to prove our presence in a good way. So we have attended all and we have visited all these regions. Today, in Iraq, Iraq is facing the occupation by ISIS in Mosul. Or this Daesh occupation, although it is by an oppressive, aggressive force called Daesh, but the members of Daesh consist of 62 countries, different countries, as if the other countries were sleeping, were not aware of that, and they only woke up when they found their sons and their citizens are fighting in Iraq against peace, against history, against civilization. Who is Iraq? Iraq does not bet, nobody would think that it's more important than Iraq and stronger than Iraq. If you want to see and to know what's Iraq, you should go up to the highest highest mountains of history, and you'll find Iraq there. I have the honor of being Iraqi, but this is a fact that the source of civilization in the world goes back to the fourth millennium before Christ, when Imara Nasriya in Iraq. This is a fact. Those people are fighting the civilization. That's why they chose to fight Iraq. And they're fighting humanity. And they are fighting coexistence and the social coexistence in Iraq, because several religions in Iraq. Iraq is not the biggest country, but it's the deepest country in its societal components. Iraq has different religions, different sects, different nationalities, ethnicities, and political parties. So when you speak about, we speak about all these different ideas. Suddenly, we found that the forces of terrorism penetrated and occupied the city of Mosul, which is the second biggest city in Iraq after Baghdad. They penetrated that and controlled it. And that's why we find that all the countries of the world were said they were ready to defend Iraq and stand by Iraq. We appreciate this, and we think that they should stand by us, because this battle is not Iraq's battle only, because Iraq is fighting on behalf of itself and on behalf of all the countries of the world, whether the Gulf countries, the Islamic countries, the Arab countries, Europe, Latin America. And I said that in New York, in fact, those who are fighting Iraq represent all your countries. So why shouldn't they go back to your, wouldn't they go back to your countries and the same terrorism in your countries also? And in fact, there is terrorism that took place in Canada, and the Canadian experience, as you know, in democracy history, is the best kind of democracies in the world. They entered the parliament in Canada and killed the guards there. When I telephoned the Prime Minister of Canada, I did not know that what I had warned against a few days ago in New York would happen so fast and in this country. This is the terrorism. The terrorism fights everybody. This has no friends. Terrorism is an insurgency against all peaceful people. No country in the world should think that they are safe from terrorism. Terrorism is against all humanity. They hate all humanity. They hate innocence of children. They hate elderly people. They hate women and chastity of women. Nobody should think that this Iraq only has a problem. That's why this ugly image of terrorism unified the world against it, and the world has unified and met. And the New York meeting was a very good one. All the countries of the world agreed on the lines. And when I was Security Council, I heard the speeches of the representatives of different countries. Everyone insisted on the following. First, that there should be a distinction between Daesh and Islam, because Islam has nothing to do with Daesh. Second, that these savage positions do not represent Islam, and that might be transferred to their own countries. And also they said that they bear a responsibility to stand by Iraq, and they must prove that they stand by Iraq so that Iraq doesn't think that it is alone. That's why they are standing by us. We have not created this international coalition, but we accepted it because it helps us. What we did, we only is that we put some conditions that such support should not be the prelude to a military intervention and to bring back foreign bases into our country. That's why we said we don't want any bases, we don't want any fleets and military forces in Iraq. We don't have a shortage of men. Iraq is running the battles now, and the battles are run today by the heroes, the Iraqi heroes, who are facing and confronting these and push them back, and in such a way that they withdrew from many places, recently they were near Baghdad and Jurf al-Sakhr and in the Ishaqi or Hamrin in Diyala or in Beji, and they were also near very close to Anbar, but now they are withdrawing and going back. So our policy, as the title of tonight's event is on the foreign policy of Iraq or diplomacy of Iraq, the Iraqi diplomacy cannot distance itself from what's happening in Iraq in general and especially in the provinces. But we say that we deal with these variables in a way that safeguards Iraq's diplomatic position. There are some differences, of course, everyone knows, between countries. Today, Yemen is facing a military intervention. We had to have a clear position regarding that. We said that in the Arab Summit, that we do not approve intervention of any country in the affairs of others, politically and also militarily. We rejected that. We did not agree and did not support the idea of this military intervention in Yemen, just as we won't accept that against any country, no matter what the country is invading or what country is defending. So we set up this position of Iraq and consider that this is a strategic position taken by Iraq. And there, even between the neighboring countries, we want to have good relations with them, but we intervene. We try to avoid going into any battles. In our relations with any country, doesn't mean that we should boycott Syria, for example, or boycott Iran. We have opened ourselves to Turkey, but without that being at the expense of Syria, we visit Syria without this being at the expense of our relations with Turkey. We want to be open to all this country without any prices to pay. And in fact, sometimes there's an opportunity to bring these countries closer to each other. And we are very proud that we try to bridge the gap between the different countries without any hesitation. Our constants will remain the same, then they will guide our policies. We are today, just as we were in the past, that the Iraq is witnessing an openness, accepting the different initiatives that are and the invitations sent to us from different countries until we reach New Zealand and Australia, and a few days ago in Belarus and Russia, which are countries were not visited by any minister, Iraqi foreign minister in the past. These are the good relations. So that to reach memorandums of understanding, and because Iraq needs to promote these relations on field bases that we need in Iraq.
These dossiers that we have dealt with, they relate to economy, agriculture, services, human aid, and indeed security. Providing that this does not violate our sovereignty and our credibility. It is worth noting that these dossiers are very sensitive, however, the insistence of Iraq to be open and to invest into such relationships, not to meddle into others' affairs. These are the new features of the policy of Iraq. The Arab countries, indeed, there are plenty of links that we stretch. We are brethren. Some of the regimes are different. Some they are republics, monarchies, and so on and so forth. We do not interfere in anybody's affair. However, we dissociate ourselves sometimes, but we have to build confidence without meddling into their affairs. There is also an overlap that relates to the history, geography, religion, language, and kinship. So our relationship with the Arab world is good. There are some bumps on the road, but our relationships are good. We have visited the Arab countries. We have accepted the invitations, and we were honored to receive them in Baghdad. And in the recent months, we had reciprocal visits with the Arab world. Perhaps the chairman will be asking me some questions now, because I perhaps took much of your time. Thank you very much indeed.
Again, thank you very much. Ambassadors who are here, as well as the Iraqi delegation, and of course Ambassador Nawar, the chargé of Iraq. I hope we can do something about the feedback. Yes? Okay, I'll keep talking. Thank you very much, Dr. Jaffrey. In fact, you were perfect in terms of your timing. And you, before we get on to the foreign policy issue, you said right at this, throughout in your statement, in your lecture, that of course Iraqi foreign policy cannot distance itself from what's happening in Iraq itself. And of course, you emphasized the fight against terrorism, which you see as the biggest, as one of the biggest threats in the region, and of course in Iraq itself. I must ask you in that context with regards to Tikrit and what happened in Tikrit and what is happening in Tikrit. There is cooperation between the Iraqi army, other militia forces, and the United States and Iran. And for many, this is a model of what can be achieved elsewhere. But since, particularly the entering of Tikrit, there has been criticism of some of the abuses by particular armed groups. And is Tikrit a model for what we can see in the future? And how are we going to be able to make sure that we don't get the abuses which are being reported? And here I refer also to the Reuters bureau chief, Ned Parker, who has had to leave the country.
بالنسبة لاستراتيجينا استراتيجيتنا في مواجهة الإرهاب في تكريت أو المناطق الأخرى قبلها أيضا في منطقة ال
We had witnessed this in Diyala earlier, depending on the Iraqi security forces. The new thing is the popular mobilization forces, which was fighting under the umbrella of the Iraqi forces, as well as the Peshmerga, the National Guard, as well as the clans. They are all working under the umbrella of the Iraqi armed forces. They resemble a melting pot, and they do not violate, they do not bypass the command and control of the Iraqi forces. Indeed, we have made progress, and we ask to have some advisors from some countries. We have refused to have further assistance, save the advisors. So what we asked, we asked for advisors from different parts of the world, and we had no troops on the ground at all, and we have refused that, and the Iraqi armed forces did resemble the spearhead of such forces, and we have indeed made progress, and everybody witnessed that in the previous...
Thank you. There is, of course, in this fight against terrorism, a level of coordination with other states. Much has been said of Iran and Iran's role at the invitation of the government of Iraq. And then, of course, there is the role of the United States in this respect as well. How is this role being coordinated?
وأكد مرة أخرى أن
الحضور الإيراني ولا الإيران أو محصور في حدود تحت مفهوم أمريكا provides assistance when it comes to aid and advisors per se. يعني كانت بعده لم تتحرك لمواجهة داعش في مصر. Those who took the initiative هو إيران. Were the Iraqis. What can the Iraqis do if the second city of Iraq has been occupied by terrorists. Do you think that we need to wait for them to move to Salah ad-Din, Anbar, Diyala, Baghdad? It was natural to receive these advices. So it was a consultative kind of assistance. And then the alliance was formed, and we agreed to it. And indeed, Iran had helped us, China had helped us, and they both were outside the vicinity of the alliance itself, Russia as well. So we have cooperated with the coalition, and we had our own conditions. We have not and we will not have troops on the ground that are foreign. Those who run the show are pure Iraqis. We receive logistic assistance, sometimes aerial bombardment, sometimes advisors on the ground. When the Iranian advisors, for example, are on the ground and they are on field, indeed, they will have consultative kind of function. We do so with everyone. Thank you.
We understand there are about 3,000 or so American military advisors on the ground. How many are there from Iran in this respect? Is there some idea?
Frankly speaking, I don't know the numbers, but I think 3,000 is a good figure, and from each country according to their expertise. But I don't have the exact figures of each country. But frankly speaking, we have asked for advisors and these advisors, but we don't know their exact figures. I'm sorry.
You are also, of course, Iraq is said to be playing an important role in the fight against Daesh in Syria, in the sense that you have international coalition military aircraft who are bombing Daesh in Syria, and you also have, of course, I would say that, of course, to a certain degree, it is said that Iraq is also playing a coordination role in Syria in the fight against Daesh, meaning that you have international coalition aircraft, U.S. aircraft, for example, which are bombing Daesh targets in Syria. And at the same time, you have, of course, Bashar al-Assad and his forces also bombing various parts of Syria. To what extent is this coordination role so that in many ways people have seen a pattern that they are not attacking each other or hitting each other, so someone must be playing a coordination role?
The coordination is not at the level of operation, military of operations, defense and attack. No, we don't have such a coordination. But two times there was such a kind of coordination. In one time, the American administration, through the Minister of Foreign Affairs, said that wanted to send a message to Syria saying that there will be bombardment of Daesh bases in Syria. When we saw the nature of the message or letter, and I also just suggested some extra points, the letter became in the following way, that shelling against Daesh in Syria is not to fight the regime, but to fight only Daesh on Syrian ground, which is something related to what's happening in Iraq. I conveyed this message, and it was expressed by the Syrians, and the Syrians did say that there was this coordination with the mediation of Iraqi foreign minister. 2 days or 3 days ago, I was also abroad, and the United Nations got in touch with me, asking me that before getting into the camp, they were afraid that the civilians would be attacked. So they wanted us to get in touch with Syria, and that's why I called the foreign minister of Syria and told him that the attack on the Palestinian camp should not be against the civilians, and that the civilians should be spared any Syrian bombardment. I conveyed this message, and there was a good response to that. They said we will not do that, but there are some people inside the camp that are going to intervene, not us from us for military forces or coordination with military with Syria. No, the only what has been happening in on the Iraqi ground.
Turning to Syria more specifically, of course, the phenomena of Daesh has affected both you and both Iraq and Syria. As you said, there are areas occupied in both countries by Daesh. But I want to take you to your past as somebody who lived in exile for many years, who fought for change and for the end of suffering and dignity for Iraqis in your fight against Saddam Hussein. You must recognize that there are many in Syria who are also unhappy with the years of Ba'ath Party rule under Hafez al-Assad and now Bashar al-Assad, and who are fighting also for their dignity and for their freedom, and many who are now also living in exile and wanting a political change in their country. What would you say to them?
I would say to them that we are with the peoples of the world, and through peoples that we decide what are our positions and attitudes to regards governments. When the Arab Spring took part, it took place in Tunisia, and the people revolted against Zain, the president. We were the Syrian people, and with the Libyan people revolted against Gaddafi. We were with the people, and that was the case even with the Egyptian people and the many people against Ali Abdullah Saleh. We did not hesitate. We never hesitate that we take the side of the people and regarding the governments. But what happened in Syria, there is a very big difference in the streets of Syria. The people, some of the people are with, some of the people are against. That's why we had a neutral position, because some Syrians reject President Bashar al-Assad, and there are other Syrians who love him and want him to stay. So we said it's not our business to intervene in there. Just as we don't accept anybody to intervene in our affairs, we don't interfere. So we are on the side of the people. We are always with the people, and we build our strategies and relations on the basis of the people, because governments change, the rulers change, but the people stay, and they are always there. The strategy of Iraq is based on the civilization. For long, long years, the strategy is based on understanding these peoples and the exchange of interests with them without intervention. When they agree upon something, we are with the people. When the people reject something completely, we are with them. But when there are differences between them, we take a step behind and take a neutral position. The Syrian people, some of them are with, some of them are against the regime.
Thank you. On Syria, though, isn't it time for a political process and a political transition along the Geneva One principles, which talks about the transfer of full executive authority to a transitional government?
Just 2 weeks ago, I was in a visit just before the Arab Summit. On my way to the Arab Summit, in fact, I had visited Damascus and visited President Bashar Assad and also the foreign minister, Walid al-Muallam. It's true that was a short trip, only for 4 hours, but we discussed in the bilateral discussions we had all these issues. And the Iraq's position was clear. I expressed that we agree with solving the problem politically in Syria. We do not separate or distinguish the inside or outside of Syria. Syria must take the initiative of some political steps and sending a message to the Syrian people and to the Syrian peoples of the region that they are serious to make a transition or make a change for a solution. And I gave them some examples of some practical steps that are expected by Syrian people, such as the release of some of the innocent detainees, to put an end to the rule of one party, and to have some modifications of the constitution, and to set up the dates for comprehensive elections. President Bashar was responsive positively with these points, and he said the era of one rule party has come to an end. So what we spoke frankly to them, and we said that you want the, and he said that you want the region to be stable and suitable, because he says that any Syrian lost is a loss for us, whether he's in the opposition or from or with the regime, whether civilian or military. Our message was clear to him that he said to defend. We had, as Iraq, the same position regarding Yemen. Why did we reject the intervention in Yemen? We have no borders, geographic borders with Yemen. We have no any sensitivities regarding Saudi Arabia. No, they are brothers there for us. And Saudi Arabia is our neighboring country with Yemen. But we rejected the intervention because this intervention is military, and we refuse any kind of intervention. And I think it's easy to launch a war, but it's not easy to put an end to it. I think that the entry of militaries or militarizing the political differences is a danger and a risk, and that will lead to bloodshed for generations.
Thank you.
Shukran.
Let us turn to Yemen for a second. Surely the military intervention in Yemen is legitimate because the president of the country has asked for it. Also, it comprises a broad coalition of Arab countries. And quite short time, you had 10-member coalition which has been supporting this intervention. Is that not an argument that can be made with regards to the military intervention, Saudi-led military intervention in Yemen?
Yeah. We were clear in this, that it's not in the interest of anyone to have military intervention in Yemen, and that we think that this intervention will remind people of what happened in the 60s at the time of Jamal Abdel Nasser. What was the result of that intervention? The withdrawal. At that time, Egypt was the Jamal Abdel Nasser was the star of the region, and he had such a big popularity. Nevertheless, he had to withdraw after losing a big number of his soldiers. So we don't want Arabs to fight each other. We don't want interventions. And we distinguish very much between the intervention that happens in these countries and the intervention of the international coalition that came to Iraq and that has supported Iraq. There's a big difference. In Iraq, the fighting people that have no relation with Iraq are not from Iraq. They come from outside. While as what's happening in Yemen, this is something Yemeni. The Houthis are Yemenis. They have the same rights and obligations. And the result, they are part of the people. And you may differ with them, you might reject them here, accept them there, but you cannot say that they are not Yemenis. While as we in Iraq, we are facing foreigners. And we are facing the same countries that are the coalition, the international coalition now, have created these groups of evil because they revolted against their own countries. So there's a big difference what's happening in Iraq and Yemen. That's why we think that one should distance oneself from the language of war and fighting. Otherwise, the region would be at the brink of a very dangerous war that can begin, but we don't never win till end.
Thank you. Of course, some would say in Iraq there are many Iraqis who are fighting as well, even with Daesh. But with regards to Yemen, how can we de-escalate this situation? How the reality is that the Houthis are still trying to enter Aden, and that the boots on the ground are actually perhaps Iranian as well as other boots which are propelling this. Is this a wrong characterization? And secondly, my original question, how can we de-escalate the situation? Because it seems the UN Security Council, even the Saudi-led coalition, and the other external regional players, Iran, do want the restart of a political process.
I would like to comment on something that you had just inserted in a very clever way, that in Iraq also there are Iraqis who are fighting with Daesh. How many Iraqis are with Daesh? They are being forced to fight. Those who entered Iraq represent 62 countries. They entered into Mosul. Of course, will they control Mosul and enforce the mobilization of people? They cannot say no, especially with the brainwashing. The Daesh is not an Iraqi phenomena, while as the Houthis is a Yemeni phenomena. As for how to solve or de-escalate, what the militaries cannot do and the armies cannot do can be done by the political process. I am not a Yemeni, and I will not allow myself to intervene in their affairs and not allow any country to do so. The Yemenis should solve their own problems by their own selves. The terrorism moves from one country to another, but as happened in our case. But I think the problems in a country can be filled by the Yemenis themselves, by the political process. We shall give them the opportunity to do so by any way. Maybe the issue of the solving the Yemeni issue by political means, I would contribute and give my ideas, and I would even get in touch with some of the Yemenis without an intervention. I would give them my points of view, my advice. But that President Abbas Abdu is elected by the people, yes, this is true. But this does not mean that when he faces problems with his own people, he should use and ask the help from other countries to. For military reasons or by military means, because this will draw the whole region to military intervention. There'll be a very dangerous precedent. So we agree with this political solution and with the good efforts, political efforts, to solve this problem. And even if we are asked to do, we can play a role. We will not hesitate to accept to do so, but we don't agree with the military solution.
Thank you. Thank you. I know your time is short, and we have probably about another 15, 20 minutes. Before I turn it over to the floor, I have just one more question on the Arab Joint Military Force. As you were coming from the Arab League summit a short while ago, Iraq's position was in principle not against it, but you had some comments on this at the summit. Do you think this is ultimately a goal worth working towards, something that there should be created in order to ensure the security of Arab states?
If I go back to history, I want to recall the EU. The EU, indeed, they had a war, the 116 years war between France and the UK. Indeed, they are on good terms now. The military force has taken a decision. Any country that is occupied, as in Poland or Czechoslovakia, former Czechoslovakia, will be an attack on everyone. So the NATO has been founded. Indeed, they liberalized the economy as well, and the EU has become an economy for everyone, and that's how the economic zone has surfaced. The EU is enjoying the Danish cheese and the German cars. Every single European is enjoying these bounties. So the EU has pressed ahead, and this was a good example to follow.
But
the studies and the preludes were not surfaced out of the blue. Iraq, for example, has received this out of the blue. Iraq played a major role in Jordan, in Syria, in Palestine, in Egypt, in the past. Our heroes played a major role in such countries. Would it be possible to talk about this matter without any preparations? The decision of the foreign ministers, I don't think that this is a good example to follow. We needed to pave the way, we need to have a change of event. We didn't resort to cacophony. We said that this is a good idea, however, it can't be improvised or it can be hastened. This was our position, and that's why the principle was respected by us. However, the Iraq ought to have been revised, and as you know, in 1921 the Iraqi military institution was founded, and we had academies after academies, and some of the heads of the states were graduates of the military Iraqi academy. It wasn't feasible for the Iraq just to vote out of the blue.
Thank you. Final question to you before I do open it up, and that is the United States. The United States and Iraq, many say that 2003 was a watershed moment for U.S. Foreign policy and its invasion of and occupation of Iraq. Others, of course, would say that that they did the right thing. Now, as President Obama looks to his own legacy in foreign policy, and surely the Iranian nuclear deal is a very important part of it, what would be your advice to him as he looks at this region in turmoil? And there are many who say that the United States is damned if it does and damned if it doesn't. And, of course, President Obama came into this saying, we will take you out of the conflicts of the Middle East. In a region in turmoil, what is your advice to the President?
Perhaps I would say an outlandish kind of comment. We were not accepting the invasion of Iraq in 2003. You will be surprised, and everyone will be surprised. At that time, I was at the Islamic Dawah Party, and I was the only person who refused to join the conference of London in 2002. When I met the Americans first time, I said, how could you change the regime? Oh, here they asked me indeed, how could you change the regime? I said, you can't change the regime, you can't topple it following the military intervention. This cannot happen, this will inflict harm on the civilians. The Iraqi citizens cannot perceive the bombardment and the violation of the sovereignty of the Iraq. But let bygone be bygone. That's what happened, and I was asked again, and I said there are five steps. Close your embassies in Baghdad, close the embassies of Saddam in your capitals, make Saddam a war criminal, as Milosevic has been designated, and perhaps liberate the money and lift the sanctions. The sanctions have destroyed the Iraqis. These were five steps that I floated. Indeed, I refused the intervention. However, this is what took place, and there were intersections between interests on the soil of Iraq. So it was important for us perhaps to reduce the presence of the Americans, and we did so, and we had our own conditions that they left. No people can have dictatorship, they will rebel, and no people can have occupation, they will resist. And the Iraqis understand the art of revolution, and they understood the art of resistance as well against the occupiers. And thus, Obama was judicious when he said 2011 will be the withdrawal timeline, and indeed he won the round in the second term when he met his goals. This is in brief of what has taken place in the past. I think that Iraq has proved that it can run the show. The Iraqis can support themselves. They need some support, yes, especially when our enemies are perhaps of a bigger size than Iraq. We do not have showdowns with fighters in the mountains, few here and a few there. However, we are fighting more than 62 countries. We need support, but this support perhaps ought to be entrenched within the context of bilateral kind of meetings rather than other interventions. I think Obama has met the target, and he left Iraq, and he did so in a judicious kind of manner. The people of Iraq want the liberation, and no people can wither the occupation. We need to have a new chapter open. The Middle East has recently understood the interventions. Europe had witnessed plenty of wars, the 100 years war between France and the UK or England, and the Protestant and the Catholics also had a war between them that stretched over 30 years. I think in 1816 up until 1836, do we have wars between Saudi Arabia and Iraq or between Lebanon and Syria? No, we don't have regional wars amongst themselves. The wars ought to be casted away, dispensed with, and our region cannot accept such wars, and do not hope brinksmanship can be followed. We can't say that there is a clean war and a dirty war. All wars are dirty, but we differentiate between those who launch the wars in the first place and those who defend themselves. Thank you.
I thank you very much. I thank you for even putting up with some of my sneaky questions there, so thank you very much. I know many people want to ask questions. As I said, the Foreign Minister's time is limited, so we will take a few. I'd like you to get to the point, please, as quickly as possible, so we can take as many of you as possible. The gentleman in the back. And if you could introduce yourself, please.
Muhammad Abbas, from Masr.
You have talked about the internal issues of Iraq and the foreign intervention. You have talked about Yemen. I do think that we need to work to talk about the current government that was the culmination of the American invasion of Iraq in 2003. We have a wedge between the denominations of Iraq, and we have a court system, sectarianism, and at the time of the Maliki, we had a Sunni uprising that stretched for a year, and it was repressed brutally. This has led to the militarization of the Sunni. The Qasem Soleimani was in Tikrit, and the popular mobilization forces played a role as well in perpetuating the violence.
We'll take another two, Dr. Zakaria.
سؤالين آخران. Dr. Zakaria, تفضل. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful, Your Excellency, I follow you. You are a striver for liberation. You were in exile. You have talked about the revolution, the Egyptian revolution. What do you think about the coup of Sisi, the one who killed his own people and those his own people, especially his own people? What do you think of the military intervention of Egypt in Libya? And thirdly, do you think that Qasem Soleimani is an advisor or a militant? The constitution, the Iraqi constitution that you have participated in drafting, says that the Arabs in Iraq are part and parcel of the people. How could you change the constitution so that all the Iraqis can be Arabs? Thank you.
Okay. I have the gentleman at the back there on the right.
Hazem
Mustafa from the Arab Center.
Your Excellency, Dr. Haider al-Abadi has said, and you reiterated this point, he said that the popular mobilization forces are part and parcel of the Iraqi army, and you said that we have parameters whereby we cannot interfere in other people's affairs. When it comes to the popular mobilization forces, I think that part of them are based in Damascus, and you know Damascus, Wasiq al-Fattat, al-Umari, Abu Fadl al-Abbas, and I can mention plenty of people. So how do you think that they part and parcel of the governmental forces, and they indeed are based in Syria, and they are also wreaking havoc, or has done so in Syria in the past? تفضل.
Yes, if you could.
يمكنك
yes,
أن تجيب عن الأسئلة. تفضل.
السيد محمد كان يتكلم عن التدخل الأمريكي تاريخ الأمريكي. إحنا رفضناه.
I said that I refused the U.S. intervention. Indeed, I refused it conclusively. And they said, what is the alternative? You do understand, when I was the representative of the Dawa Islamic Party, I said the following. I said that we have made sacrifice, plenty of martyrs. I have 5 martyrs from my own family. I cannot resolve the solution from the air, the aerial bombardment. We refused the intervention. When they came to Iraq, we insisted on the withdrawal, and I visited. I was the first head of the governing council, and I visited the Arab countries, and I said, take heed of Iraq. Saddam Hussein was in a difficult position, and he dissociated himself from the Arab world. I think the occupation's life expectancy is very short. Portugal and for on Brazil and Germany and France, Saddam Hussein and Kuwait and Britain and America. At the end of the day, they all left. The occupiers left because they don't resemble the society of such countries. They are foreigners at the end of the day. I speak on behalf of the bloc that I represented. I refused the American intervention, I reiterate, but they came along and we had to cope with the new circumstances. Indeed, some wicked maneuvers took place, and some tried to drive a wedge between the Sunnis and the Shias. We refused that. All the cities in Iraq accommodate Shiites and Sunnis, and I have numbers. I can answer anyone who has doubts. From Basra to Mosul, we have Sunnis and Shiites in every single governorate. In Basra, we might have a majority of Shiites. In Mosul, we have the opposite, a majority of Sunnis and a minority of Shiites. Every single tribe, the Arab tribes, accommodate Sunnis and Shiites. In addition to that, the intermarriages is 26.9%. 26.9%. That means plenty of Iraqis descend from a Shiite mother and a Sunni father, or the opposite, or the way around. The provocation and perhaps the destabilization efforts from abroad. They were foreign. They were nothing to do with the Iraqis. We had lived peacefully.
I
would like to give you some examples. In 2005, I formed the second government, and the brother, the Sunnis, had 17 MPs from the General Assembly. Some said that we had only one minister. I had the capacity to perhaps have more ministries. I said to the other bloc that there are 17 because they were boycotted from entering the parliament. The Shiite had a different arrangement. Mr. Al-Abadi, Mr. Al-Maliki, I said to them that you can wait 3 months from now. I cannot form a government unless I increase
the quota of the Sunnis on a par with the weight. Osama Al-Jaifi, Saadun Al-Dalaimi came along, Sayyid Al-Zahra, I brought seven more. So there is no schism between the Shiite and the Sunnis in Iraq. There are provocations, there are people who try to drive a wedge. However, as I said, there's no difference between the Sunnis and the Shias. Sectarianism is not an Iraqi plant. Iraq, if you go back to the history, we had splendid coexistence and empathy. But it comes to Soleimani and the popular mobilization forces. Soleimani is an advisor. And the gentleman has asked the same question. Why are you sensitive vis-a-vis having British, French, American advisors? Also, we have advisors from Iran. It is a neighboring country. We need advisors. And Soleimani had no Iranian units on the ground. This is not allowed. Americans are not allowed. French are not allowed. British are not allowed. However, when it comes to consultancy, this is a different matter. We derive benefit from such advisors and we welcome them. And it has nothing to do with the military side. When it comes to the coup of Sisi, I cannot convince you. You are an Egyptian gentleman. You can have your own say. When it comes to me, I look through the government from the prism of the people. Mohamed Morsi came on the top of power, so be it. We dealt with him, and Sisi came along, and we dealt with him, so be it. We cannot speak on behalf of the Egyptian people. We have different convictions, and you have a different one. We cannot impose anything on the Egyptian people. It is a strictly, purely Egyptian matter. We hope for every single head of government to be civil servant, to accommodate everyone. And we hope that all the Arab leaders, including Mr. Sisi, will accommodate all the Egyptian people, and they live on the soil of Egypt at the end of the day. When it comes to
about the constitution, the question about constitution, what do you understand when you say by Arabs? I am an Arab from father to son to ancestors. My family came from a region close to Riyadh 700 years ago. I don't want Arabism to be an intellectual or a doctrine. I love Arabic, but we have Kurds, we have Turkmans in Iraq. What do we kick them out of the country? Do we stand? They are not Iraqis. They are also Kurds in Iraq, in Syria, sorry. So it's normal. So when Iraq writes down in its constitution that the Arabs are the basic component of society, it's correct, but it would be wrong to say we are the only people. Now you can see who are giving sacrifices in Iraq. Are they only the Arabs? No. The Yazidis are being killed, the women are being raped. These are all Iraqis, number of components. There's what Mr. Hazem asked about, Hazem Mustafa, asked about Libya. The Sisi aggression against Libya. I explained that we do not approve any intervention by any country against any country, especially if military. We were clear in this. Didn't you say that? Didn't you hear me what I said in the Arab summit? That we said we reject. We didn't say we have reservation. No, we said reject any military intervention in Yemen. This applies not only to Yemen, to other countries also. We don't have double standards. We all have the same standard. We don't hesitate, and we insist that we should have good relations with them. As for the popular mobilization that are the part of the army and how they have branches in Syria, that question. They are part of the Iraqi armed forces, and they were created as a result of a call from the religious authorities under the leadership of the Iraqi army, and they are now part of the army or the armed forces. So when Mr. Sayyid Sistani made this fatwa that this is kind of jihad to defend the country, this led to stopping the degradation of the situation without any distinction between Sunnis and Shi'is. But to say that some of them have branches outside Iraq, we are not no longer the dictatorship of Saddam Hussein. This is the price of democracy. We say frankly, we do not accept that any Iraqi citizen should intervene in the affairs of other countries, but we cannot oppress them. We cannot stop them. But there is an official Iraqi point of view that we are against any intervention, military intervention. But as there are a number of Iraqis or individuals who would intervene here and there. If you look at these militias that are coming into Iraq and these Daesh forces, how many countries are there? Well, more than 62 countries are present in Daesh. The Iraqis are not so very much present in other countries. It is said there are some Iraqis in Syria. Let's suppose so. Is it the government that is going to do so? Can the government stop them doing so? This is something mathematical more than political that you're saying. There was a question. Have I forgotten any question?
No, this is good. This is good.
Yes, it seems there is a question. Yes, I hear what you hear, and I assure you that any violation by the popular militias is not accepted, except there are some individual cases and incidents that are rejected totally, rejected by the religious authorities, by the government, by the political forces. But maybe there's a stupid guy might kill a Shi'i, or a Sunni kid kills a Shi'i, or vice versa. These are individual incidents that are rejected by two. This is not a position taken by the government or by the sect. Why haven't you judged Saddam Hussein as a representative of the Sunnis when he did what he did in Halabja and Anfal, when he killed tens of thousands of people? Only 300, 500 were burned in Halabja. 365,000 in the middle and the south of country were buried alive. Why don't you say that the Sunnis did that? No, we didn't say that. We said Saddam did that. Let's suppose that a stupid person did something stupid against these people. This represents the whole sect. If you want to judge any sect through one individual, we should choose the best of the individuals, not the others.
Thank you.
There are many hands raised, but I will not give the word to three. I will start with the lady in the back. Please. I am from Mosul, and I have a question about liberation of Mosul. It will not be easy. How will you avoid many victims and many innocent people being killed? You said the people and the tribes are supporting you. Please elaborate on that. And is there a decision about the roles of the militias or the popular militias in Mosul? سؤال من سيدة أخرى هل هناك سيدة أخرى تسأل؟ عرفي بنفسك رجاءً. ريم الحرمي. You said that there is a Daesh is occupying Iraq. Don't you take the big security gap that is the result that led to Daesh being able to occupy Iraq? Abdul Hamid Qutb from Al Sharq newspaper. Your Excellency, what do you think about some testimonies of people of Tikrit who said that crimes were perpetrated by the popular mobilizing forces, which were more, even more than what Daesh did to people. Another question, Al-Abadi government, is it different from Al-Maliki government? Some people say they are the same, and that the dealing with the Sunnis on both governments is the same. السؤال الأخير للشاب هنا سأشتري لك قهوة لاحقا. What about the freedom of press in Iraq? The director of Reuters had to leave Iraq because he was attacked or he was threatened to because he spoke of the popular mobilization forces. repeat your question. What did you say about after the freedom of press? I'm Noor Khatib from New Arab, Al Arabi Jadid. The question, I want you to comment on the freedom of press in Iraq. The director of Reuters in Iraq, who revealed the violations made by the popular militias in Tikrit, was threatened to be killed and he had to leave Iraq. حسنا لن اشتري له قهوه ساسمح له بيسال السؤال انه يصر على القاء السؤال فراس فوادي from بلادي تي في دكتور after all these questions after today's conference and here in this meeting this beautiful event there are so other many questions so I a question comes to my mind for how long people are misunderstanding Iraq or seeing Iraq only through what the, some satellite stations are saying. Why don't they understand Iraq the way the people are saying? There are so many questions that you have answered, and you know what the people of Iraq are doing. So my question is, why are people insisting, imposing, and raising such questions that are full of poison? I will begin with the lady. I also a graduate of University of Mosul, and I lived some 8 years and a half in Mosul city. I was not just a student in university. I was almost a citizen in the society of Mosul because I had such a big relations with all the Mosulis. Al-Mosul is a city that does not easily accept occupation. It was occupied by Hajjaj Yusuf Thaqafi in the history a long time ago, but failed. And a Persian king, Nader Shah, tried also to occupy it and failed during the red tide of the communists in Iraq, the Mosulis fought the communists. But I know that Mosul had been not very well run. Some efforts were made by the local government or the central government in a way that led to some contest and the spread of some corruption in the country, especially with the military, in such a way Mosul became accepted or provided a good incubator for Daesh. That's why we have wanted to correct this, and we moved to see how we can get rid of these tensions and reestablish the trust of the people of Mosul in their government and their people. Now, when the different political Iraqi parties agreed on 20 points under the title of a pact of honor, one point was that the government should be composed of all the components of society. And actually, this is the case now. The government and the parliament represent all the people, and Mosul has its share. You know that Mosul love military life, and we have 21,000 officers from Mosul. The Minister of Defense now is from Mosul, our good friend Khalid al-Ubaidi. These are facts you should know. Mosul was occupied by sudden, was taken by surprise, and that's why Mosul, in my opinion, will regain its position and its prestige and will be victorious because at a long, honorable history of resistance, every street in Mosul has seen fights and given martyrs. Hafs al-Umari and so many other heroes from Mosul were courageous and fought the enemy. The popular mobilization force in Mosul, some people of Mosul, we have joined this mobilization. The mobilization forces were not formed on sectarian basis. Of course, their units from Anbar are from Anbar people and from Mosul. They are from Mosul. Had we adopted this policy right from the beginning, Mosul would not be have been occupied. And let me, after permission of Mr. Salman Turman, give an example of the Second World War. Hitler at the time would occupy Czechoslovakia and then occupy Poland and then France and occupy Norway, Ireland, the US. Why didn't he occupy Switzerland? It was close to him and there was no army in it. I looked for a reason and the result was that Switzerland had a strong internal national resistance. Had the Nazi army gone into Switzerland, it would have been Switzerland would have been a graveyard for all the army. That's why we wanted all our provinces create their own internal resistance, popular resistance, not only for objective reason that they know each other. This is the case now, and the mobilization forces are now different depending on the region they are. They are not Kurds against Arabs or Sunnis against Shia. No, each region or each province has its own forces. As for sectarianism, the second question that terrorism is more dangerous than Daesh occupation. This is not true. I cannot say that all the people who are part of these forces, but also I do not accept that one should judge on the popular mobilization at the time when they fought so heroically and they were the first line of the fire of the battles. They became the battle that defended Iraq at the time. There was no international coalition, no. They were only themselves with the people there fighting even before the announcement of their creation. They moved as individuals. But if a stupid person here or there violates the rules or does something bad, this is an exception. Every country has seen such exceptions of individuals of a group of people that might do so. As for sectarianism, and it's all in the occupation of Daesh. I think Daesh did benefit from the sensitivities and the injustice that took place and the administrative corruption. All this provided a good environment for Daesh. That's why the new government, when it was formed, it was informed not by a touch on a button. No, this new government confronted these issues and coordinated between the federal government and the regional government and modified some rules and rebalanced some compositions. And we provided a better environment and results. That's why the results were excellent. Please don't accept what you hear from the gentleman said that we shouldn't accept. I respect what the last gentleman said that the media is now nourishing you should understand Palestine only through the Palestinians, and you shouldn't understand Libya from through the Libyans, and you should understand Yemen through Yemenis, and the Bahrain through Yemenis, and Iraq through Iraqis. The media is not on our side. And unfortunately, some of the media people have proved, not all of them, that they take positions, some of them, they follow the appeal of money and of gold, they say. I invite you all, anyone who is a Muslim, and we invite anyone of you to come to Iraq. What are the impressions when he came to Iraq and what will be his impressions when he leaves Iraq? I invite you because I saw other people in the past who came to Iraq and changed their impressions. But anyone who comes to Iraq will see that the situation is different from what is said in the media. The Iraqi media people are heroes. We give more than 300 martyrs. We have Atwar Behjet. I called her Afra. She was killed in Samarra, and she is from Sunni. They killed her in her own region in Samarra. So the war does not seem to be Sunnis and Shiites. The criminals are from all sides and the victims are from all sides. Come to Iraq and see by yourselves what's happening. Anyone who wants to come, I invite them at our expense to see on the field what's the reality in Iraq. I don't know if I've answered all the questions. Please remind me if there's a question I didn't answer. Yes, about Reuters director. Nothing is new in that. I don't want to doubt this news, but I would say that only this is a short or a lacking analysis. If somebody goes into a country and see into a hospital and see sick people there, one cannot say that all the people of this country are sick and in hospitals. No, you must come to Iraq and see for yourselves, see how the armed forces and the popular militias, are they all the same kind or different? See if is there a general phenomena. You know, what happened in Sinjar was with the Yazidis, who have a long history in Iraq. Everybody defended those Yazidis, the Sabis, the Yazidis, the Christians, the Muslims, the Kurds. Iraq is made of all these components, but what you hear from the media is not enough. Let me give you a word, and through you to your viewers and readers, I want the media to be a message of the prophets. The media I saw, I from Iraq, I see things in my eyes, and then I see what the media is saying and what's writing. And I see that they don't write what reality, but they write on the basis either of their interest or ignorance. There are, of course, some heroic media people who came to Iraq. For I'm not against Reuters, but I must say that there is no such phenomena as what was said by Reuters. I don't know if there are any other questions I didn't answer.
I think you've been a very good sport, Your Excellency, and the time you've spent and the patience at which you've answered all the questions, I thank you very much. I thank you very much for coming to join us at the Brookings Doha Center for this very special lecture. I also thank your delegation. And all I have to say is I think we should show our appreciation to His Excellency, the Foreign Minister of Iraq, for being with us this evening. Thank you again very much. Pleasure.